entertainer, an actor both in person and through his voice, and an Oregon-born individual who not only left his mark everywhere he went, but he enjoyed what he did until the very end. This is how someone would describe the curious case of one Dallas McKennon. Dallas first began his career by working in local radio in Portland, Oregon. Initially, he voiced a radio program meant for children, and not soon after, he would go on to provide voices in radio dramas, one of which was called The Silent Men, which also featured the voice of Douglas Fairbanks Jr.
The secretary said you were a federal agent.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, what do you want to see me about?
You had a Catherine McDonald working for you some time ago.
Hmm? Working? A light-headed, gum-chewing incompetent.
Any ideas to her whereabouts?
She would hardly have reason to keep in touch with me. I had to discharge her.
Why?
Incompetence, I told you before.
You haven't seen her since?
Who says I have?
Nobody. I just asked.
Well, I haven't.
When the advent of television came around, he created a character called Captain Jet, who would host a TV wraparound show for children that featured reruns of Hal Roach's The Little Rascals and various Laurel and Hardy films. In 1952, he would meet famous Western actor Jimmy Stewart, who was making a Western picture in Portland, co-starring Rock Hudson and directed by Anthony Mann. Both Mann and Stewart were looking for actors to fill in minor roles, and McKennon jumped at the chance. The picture was called Bend of the River, and McKennon would make his film debut near the beginning of the third act. Here, he plays one of two miners who are wanting to bargain for food from a wagon train.
Anything you paid for that grub will give you 10 times what it cost if you bring it into the diggings.
10 times?
Hey, that's a lot of money.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
I'm afraid our food is not for sale.
Why not?
It means a new life for 100 people.
Yeah, sure you won't change your mind?
I'm afraid not.
Historians Tim Hollis and Greg Urbar once wrote, at age 32, McKennon managed to look much older in his cameo role as a toothless old gold miner in the film. Because of this, Stewart himself encouraged McKennon to move to Hollywood, and he would help him secure his first agent. Upon getting his first agent, he would get a call from a cartoon producer named Walter Lance. He worked for Universal, and he was the creator of what was then called the nation's number one laugh bird.
Guess who?
Woody Woodpecker. Lance was familiar with his work in radio beforehand, and so he called McKennon, asking if he could do some voices for his productions. He said yes, kicking off a long relationship. By the 1960s, he would do voices for over 50 cartoons produced by Lance. He would not only voice minor characters, but he would go as far as voicing the adversaries of the main character. For example, Buzz Buzzard in Hot Noon or 12 O'Clock for Sure.
Are you ready, Biz? Okay, Booze. Let's go, Buzz. Wait a minute! I'll handle this myself.
In a 2003 interview, Dallas was asked about what it was like working with Walter Lance and his associates. He said, "Every call would be another highlight in my Hollywood life. I got more individual attention there than with any other studio I worked with. It was a fun time, not a work time." He was also asked what his favorite cartoon was that Walter Lance produced. His favorite was The Legend of Rockabye Point, directed by Tex Avery. His reason? The film was initially designed for him to do all of the voices. Already he has established himself by doing a wide range of voices, and so it was inevitable that he would receive a call from the House of Mouse. In 1955, he participated in his first official project for the Walt Disney Company, the first animated CinemaScope feature, Lady and the Tramp. Though again voicing minor roles, Dallas provided the voices of 4 different characters. A wandering professor who gets in a fight with a police officer, 2 of the dogs in the pound, one with a Boston accent and the other a Mexican accent, and... yep, he would do the voice of the laughing hyena. After this, he would do a few more projects for the Disney studio. A few of these projects would include 101 Dalmatians from 1961, Son of Flubber from 1963, and Mary Poppins from 1964. As a whole, his work with Walter Lantz and Walt Disney were huge stepping stones in his acting career. Lantz and Disney weren't Dallas's only clients. He would go on to work with stop-motion animation pioneer Art Clokey 1 year after Lady and the Tramp, and Dallas would become the official voice of Gumby for television.
Now maybe you can tell me why we're way out in the middle of an African jungle like this.
Our zookeeper needs a lion. You wouldn't want to see a zoo without a lion, would you?
No. If it's anything I can't stand, it's a zoo without lions.
He would then be introduced to George Powell, a colleague of Clokey's, best known for creating the Puppetoons, and for his work in science fiction. Dallas would work with Powell on two films. The first was a 1958 musical picture called Tom Thumb, where he would voice a character that's not too PC today.
Good morning, Mr.
Allow unworthy one to introduce your humble servant, Confucian, and bidding you, on behalf of all toys and nursery, a most glorious welcome.
The other film was a 1964 fantasy western film called The Seven Faces of Dr. Lowe. In this, he appears as a heckling cowboy. Finally, in that same year as Dr. Lowe, he would return back to television, playing a character named Cincinnatus, a tavern keeper, in the TV series Daniel Boone, and he would appear for 81 episodes throughout its entire run.
Cincinnatus, I've been thinking. How long has it been since you broke that fiddle of yours out of its rapids?
Recollect it was, at the Loomis Cabin raising last spring.
Well, don't you figure it's just about time you broke it out again?
Oh, what a wonderful idea.
I don't want to seem ungrateful for the chance to play, but what are we celebrating?
Well, it's called a celebration in honor of all of our visitors.
Be worth a try.
From what has been shown, Dallas has had a thriving career throughout the 50s and 60s, and one could say that he was definitely all over the place. In a sense, that's what defined him as a character actor. He would continue to work in live action and animation in both film and television up until the 90s. In 2009, he would sadly pass away from natural causes in Raymond, Washington. But even though he's no longer alive, his work still lives on. And as newer generations discover his work, he will continue to put a smile on everyone's face.